Spirit of the Lord. Humble yourself in the sight of the Lord, and He will lift you up, higher and higher, and He will lift you up. Humble yourself in the sight of the Lord.
Welcome to worship. It's lovely to be here in spite of all the rain that's pouring down outside. And welcome to you who are worshipping with us this morning online. We're really pleased to have you with us as well. We're going to begin with Psalm 84, verses 1 to 7, and I invite you to join with me as we say it together. How lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord Almighty. My soul yearns, even faints, for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh cry out for the living God. Even the sparrow has found a home, and the swallow a nest for herself, where she may have her young. A place near your altar, Lord Almighty, my King and my God. Blessed are those who dwell in your house. They are ever praising you. Blessed are those whose strength is in you, whose hearts are set on pilgrimage. As they pass through the valley of Baca, they make it a place of springs. The autumn rains also cover it with pools. They go from strength to strength till each appears before God in Zion.
Me down to lie in peace.
Our confession of, or statement of faith this morning is from Colossians chapter 1, verses 15 to 20. We believe that the Son is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For in him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities. All things have been created through him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. And we believe he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything he might have the supremacy. For God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross. This is most certainly true. I invite Judy up to share the word of God with us.
Good morning, everyone. Our reading today is from Joel chapter 2, verses 23 to 32. Rejoice, you people of Jerusalem. Rejoice in the Lord your God, for the rain he sends demonstrates his faithfulness. Once more the autumn rains will come, as well as the rains of spring. The threshing floors will again be piled high with grain, and the presses will overflow with new wine and olive oil. The Lord says, I will give you back what you lost to the swarming locust, the hopping locust, the stripping locust, and the cutting locusts. It was I who sent this great destroying army against you. Once again, you will have all the food you want, and you will praise the Lord your God, who does these miracles for you. Never again will my people be disgraced. Then you'll know that I am among my people Israel, that I am the Lord your God, and there is no other. Never again will my people be disgraced. Then after doing all those things, I will pour out my spirit upon all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your old men will dream dreams, and your young men will see visions. In those days I will pour out my spirit even on servants, men and women alike. And I will cause wonders in the heavens and on the earth, blood and fire and columns of smoke. The sun will become dark and the moon will turn to blood red before that great and terrible day of the Lord arrives. But everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved, for some on Mount Zion in Jerusalem will escape, just as the Lord has said. These will be among the survivors whom the Lord has called. This is the word of God.
Good morning, everyone. I've called this sermon this morning, or this message this morning, not my way, but your way, dear Heavenly Father. I'll just pray. The words of that lovely Psalm 23. Father, we thank you that we can gather and have this time together. We especially thank you that even though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, we have no fear of evil, because you are with us, your rod and your staff, they comfort us. Well, as it comes around every month for my turn to give you the message, I look up the lectionary and find the Bible verses set down for the day. The passage set down for today is a few verses in Paul's second letter to Timothy. Paul's writing to his dear son, Timothy, and he's talking about his approaching death. Well, I couldn't quite believe God's timing, as all of us have to face the prospect of our death. So in our reading this morning, we see how Paul views his impending death, how he looks back on his life, and how he acknowledges that it was only God's love and strength that brought him through to the end. And I thought of a song that we're familiar with.
And now the end is near, and so I face the final curtain. My friend, I'll say it clear, I'll state my case, of which I'm certain. I've lived a life that's full, I traveled each and every highway, and more, much more than this, I did it my way. For what is a man? What has he got? If not himself, then he has not to say the things he truly feels, and not the words of one who kneels. The record shows I took the blows and did it my way.
They were the first and last verses of that song that we know, we're familiar with. And they're not the words of someone who lived humbly before his maker. Frank lived his life his own way. There are a few things that we could say about Frank's life, but not here today. However, Frank's life, Frank Sinatra's life, was the very opposite of the life that Paul lived. Paul, who wrote so much of the New Testament, did live humbly on his knees before his maker. And you can see the highlighted words, and I'm not sure who wrote it. Was it Paul Anka?
Yeah.
Yeah, Paul Anka wrote it, and they aren't the words of someone who kneels. Paul says in 2 Timothy, "For I am already being poured out like a drink offering, and the time for my departure is near. I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, I have kept the faith. Now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day. And not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing." So Paul did not do life his way. He did life God's way. So what does Paul mean when he says, "I'm being poured out like a drink offering"? There are many instances in the Old Testament where drink offerings were presented on the altar. Mostly they accompanied sacrifices of animals. The wine was poured out to the Lord. Both Jew and Gentile would have understood this illustration, this picture of a life being poured out in sacrifice and service of God. Wine was used in the worship of gods in Greek and Roman temples. Previously, Paul had written to the Philippians, and he used a similar example. "Even if I am being poured out like a drink offering on the sacrifice and service coming from your faith." Well, in this passage, Paul is not talking about his death, but rather of his life. His whole life, all of his life, was dedicated to Jesus, poured out for Jesus. We know that only Jesus made the sacrifice that would accomplish remission of sins. But Paul's life, and Paul laying down his life for Jesus, was in response to Jesus' sacrifice. Are our lives in response? Do we live our lives in response to Jesus' sacrifice? Paul tells the Romans, and he tells us in chapter 12 of Romans, "Therefore I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship." Now let's get back to Timothy. Now it's telling Timothy that his departure is near. The word departure is interesting. He doesn't say, as Frank Sinatra sings, "The end is near," but rather, "My departure is near." He's leaving one destination, departing from one place, and going to another destination. And for Paul, it's not the end, is it? In a sense, it's a beginning, a new place where he will meet the Lord and receive the crown of righteousness. And he could tell the Corinthians triumphantly to give thanks to God because the sting of death had been taken away. It had been done with. God gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. And the last enemy, death, has been defeated. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? It's gone. It's gone. And in Philippians, Paul says, "For to me to live is Christ, but to die is gain." So what a different perspective Paul had on his death to modern man. Do we view death as Paul did? You see, Paul spent a long time languishing in prisons year after year, languishing on boats, walking the byways and the highways of the ancient Roman world. And he had time to think about death and dying. He had it worked out. And it is important for us to grasp what Paul is telling us, especially those of us who are in our twilight years. Death has not only lost its sting, but it's lost its fear. So our culture believes in nothing, really. Therefore, it believes in everything. You hear it at funeral services. If the coffin is open, people will often say, "Doesn't she look wonderful?" But really, he looks dead. Or maybe they love butterflies, and there's a butterfly in our garden now, and it's her or him visiting us. People make this stuff up as they go along. In some way, it must comfort them, but really it is nonsense, and I believe any thinking person knows that. Now, the Westminster Confession, a bit heavy, but it was written in 1646, and it's a biblical and Christian statement of faith. After death, the bodies of men decay and return to dust, but their souls, which neither sleep nor die, having an immortal existence, return immediately to God, who gave them. The souls of the righteous are then made perfect in holiness and received into the highest heavens, where they behold the face of God in light and glory, and they await the full redemption of their bodies. The souls of the wicked are cast into hell, where they remain in torments and utter darkness, and they are kept for the judgment of the great day. Scripture recognises no other place except these two for the souls which have separated from their bodies. So that was really helpful for me. I hope it's been helpful for you. Well, this is good news for us, but not so good for unbelievers. When we die, we immediately go into God's presence, and Paul tells us we, each one of us, will receive the crown of righteousness, as Paul received it when he departed. Our bodies will decay until Christ appears, and we won't be eating and drinking and dancing until that day. When Christ appears, we will be united with our bodies, and then the party will begin, and not until. So back to Timothy. There's a few more verses that we had to look at today. At my defence, says Paul, no one came to my support, but everyone deserted me. May it not be held against them. But the Lord stood at my side and gave me strength, so that through me the message might be fully proclaimed and all the Gentiles might hear it. And I was delivered from the lion's mouth. The Lord will rescue me from every evil attack and will bring me safely to his heavenly kingdom. To him be glory forever and ever. Amen. So here Paul's telling us that he's been deserted by everyone. He laments the fact that everyone deserted him. It appears he was at a trial or a defence, as he calls it, and he has no friends to support him. He was let down by those he had given his life for. But the Lord stood at his side and gave him strength. Even in the worst of times, Paul knew that Jesus was with him. So since meeting Jesus on the Damascus Road and realizing that he was the Messiah, the fulfillment of God's plan of reconciliation between himself and humankind, Paul knew that Christ was with him. And Paul understood the scriptures. He was a Jew. Almost immediately after the Damascus Road incident, Paul preached that Jesus is the Son of God. And he preached it in the synagogue in Damascus. Of course, the Jews there were incredulous, and soon Paul was running for his life. This was a scenario that was repeated time and time again. Jesus had told Paul he would suffer for his name, and suffer Paul did. Paul knew his life was on the line many, many times, yet he never gave up on the mission that he had been called to do. Preach to the Gentiles, he was told, and that is what he did. Even at the end of his life, he can say, "But the Lord stood at my side and gave me strength, so that through me the message might be fully proclaimed and all the Gentiles might hear it." But Paul did more than that. We've been looking at Paul in our ladies' Bible study, and Paul changed the whole world. Paul would say that Jesus had already done that, and yet Paul was Jesus' mouthpiece, spreading the word. The world was never the same after Paul set up communities of Jews and Gentiles who were to be God's image bearers. Through these communities, the world would see the one true God and his son Jesus and learn how to live and how to think differently. The world would never be the same. Nothing would ever be the same. And Paul prayed and he prayed and he prayed and he prayed. Paul was brought up on the Jewish prayers, and he would have continued praying those prayers. Only now he could pray them through the Son, Jesus. Paul believed God and knew that he would be with Jesus one day. So as we listen to what God is saying to us through Paul, do we believe it? Do we believe that Christ wore the crown of thorns so we could wear the crown of righteousness? Or will we be like Frank Sinatra and live life our way? Or like Paul and live life God's way? On our departure date, where will we be? With Christ receiving a crown of righteousness, or somewhere else? Let's pray. Dear Jesus, we long for your appearing and say with Paul, to you be glory forever and ever. We long for you to wrap up this world and bring heaven to earth. Lord, we don't want to do life our way, but we get in the way of your goodness and mercy. Give us a heart and mind to do life your way and not our way. Amen.
Lots of good stuff there to chew over and think about. Now, I love the old hymn, "Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace." If ever there was a time in history where we need to keep our eyes on Jesus, it would be now. It's what we need to do, staying focused on Jesus. And sometimes that means turning our eyes from other things, shutting down social media for a time, deciding not to watch the news every night, not listening to the gossip going on around us. It's good when we can turn our eyes away from everything else and focus solely on the one who transcends all else, Jesus. Paul did just that, as Anne has just shown us and shared with us. Sometimes we get distracted by everything going on around us and we forget that we have a Saviour who is Lord of everything. In those times, I don't know about you, but I can become fearful or feel a sense of hopelessness, perhaps lose my direction or feel as though everything is out of control. Everything's out of my control. Feel like I'm out of control. But we know when that happens, it's time to turn our eyes back to the author and perfecter of our faith. And remember that he is seated at the right hand of the throne of God, ruling over everything. If you have times like this, maybe you're in a place like that now, then I invite you to bow your heads and let's bring our confession before the Father. Lord Jesus, so often we want to turn our eyes to you but get distracted by the wind and waves and storms that are blowing around us. We look to our own efforts and resources to deal with life's problems instead of seeking out your wisdom and guidance. Forgive us, Lord. Teach us to trust you with every part of our lives and keep our eyes always focused on you. Amen. O soul, are you wearied and troubled? No light in the darkness, you see. There's light for a look at the Saviour, and life more abundant and free. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Through death into life everlasting, he passed, and we follow him there. Or our sin no more hath dominion, for more than conquerors we are. Hallelujah. Your sins are forgiven in the name of Jesus Christ. So be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power, keeping your eyes fixed on him. Amen.
Turn inside, where justice and mercy embrace. There the Son of God gave his life for us, and our measureless debt was erased. Jesus, to you we lift our eyes. Jesus, our glory and our prize. We adore you, behold you, our Savior.
Now read the blessing responsively. The Spirit of God is upon you.
We go forth proclaiming God's love and liberation.
The Spirit of Christ is upon you.
We go forth to live lives of justice and freedom.
The power of the Spirit is upon you.
We go forth as one body, one spirit, one witness to the promises of God.
Grace, mercy, and peace be with you always.
Amen. Amen.